partnered by Times Influence.
As the Indian economy is maturing and Indian corporates have to compete with their global rivals on a level playing field, strategy will have a definite and all-important role to play. Keeping this in mind, Institute for Competitiveness and Times Network had organized an annual full-day event which brought together eminent personalities, including Professor Michael Porter of Harvard Business School and Whitney Johnson, an expert on disruptive innovation and personal disruption, to share their valuable insights on strategy, shared value and progress. We bring to you an exclusive four-part series which will propel companies to compete on the basis of value creation, innovation and strategy, and reward the efforts of the most outstanding companies for their distinct strategies which resulted in sustainable profitability and enhanced the competitiveness of India. In the first episode this week, we bring to you an opening note by Dr. Amit Kapoor, the chair of the Institute for Competitiveness, and Anil Gupta, founder of the Honey Bee Network, followed by a panel discussion on competitiveness.
It is such a privilege for me to actually invite or have you all here for the Porter Prize and the National Competitiveness Forum. This is the seventh year when we are actually organizing this event, and it has actually grown from strength to strength. I think there are some very special people that I have to thank. That includes Times Network, my friends like Anil Guptaji, Rishikesha from IIM Indore, Michael Porter, and so on and so forth. But most of all, I think I need to thank everybody who made an application for the Porter Prize this year, which has actually created this stunning process, which has actually ended up becoming one of the most coveted awards on strategy. So today what we are doing is we are talking about something very special. We are talking about innovation, competitiveness, and so on and so forth. And we have some very interesting ideas which are actually going to be discussed and floated around as we go along. In fact, the first speaker for the day, is Professor Anil Gupta. I think he's one person who does not need any introduction. He has been one person at the forefront of innovation and frugal innovation, or really talking about societal change in this country and for ages. So one person I deeply admire and respect. Without further ado, I should invite Professor Anil Gupta to deliver his keynote.
Thanks, Amit, for this wonderful platform which has become more and more strategic in itself in terms of bringing various interests together. I'm going to begin with a very provocative statement, and I hope you will forgive me for that. I have come here to celebrate, on one hand, the creativity that our society has, and to complain about lack of hunger for innovations in the industry. Large number of innovations in material science, in steel, in health, in food. You name the area, and we have innovations. And yet, not many are getting traction. So there are opportunities where needs are very clearly articulated, gap is very obvious, functionality is very clear, problem has been solved. Why doesn't it get scale then? So there's certainly a problem. And the problem is that perhaps we are either suffering from a syndrome very popular in literature called as not invented here. So if it is not an innovation from my workshop, my lab, then it is not interesting. Sorry. The open innovation framework meant that you will seek insights from anywhere. The first change that we need to bring about, if we really want to transform not only Indian industry, but Indian industries leveraging capability globally, we need to go towards what I call as innovation playground, where both inside out and outside in should be aggressively, feverishly, impatiently pursued. If I ask you, your last week's upload to download ratio, individually and from the point of view of a company, what will be the number? Is there anyone here who has it more than one? That means you have uploaded more, you have shared more knowledge than what you have downloaded. Is there anyone here? I don't find one. India is becoming a consumer of knowledge from global knowledge. We are the biggest consumer in the world, if you look at the total gigabyte that we consume in terms of downloading. But how much are we uploading? Are we saying that there is no lesson in my company which can improve the performance of the industry, not just the firm. And that will not affect my performance, because if my other company, my colleague, my competitors also improve their performance, I will have incentive to do even better. So there will be a continuous innovation in my company, because I will be creating my own competition by giving others the knowledge that I have, which they can use and perform better. Leaders do this all the time. Can we have an indicator in our board meeting how much of content, how much of data, how much of insights, how much of experiences in solving different problems did we share with others? The frugal, inclusive, and sustainable innovations are the need of the hour. Don't stop at frugal and inclusive. A 1 rupee sachet is frugal and inclusive. But the cost of collecting that plastic piece from 650,000 villages of my country is so huge that it is not frugal anymore. It is not frugal for the environment, for the earth, correct? So it should be sustainable. It should be sustainable. Use the recyclable material, use the material which can be composted, then it becomes frugal. Otherwise, it's very costly innovation. So let us not have definitions wrong. Let us not have definitions wrong, because a lot of people are propagating this myth that low cost is what frugal is. No. Low cost for whom? Not just for the company, not for the consumer, not for the supply chain, but also for the earth. For all the actors, it should be low cost. Then it is sustainable. Then it is inclusive. Otherwise, not. Thank you so much.
Welcome back. Next up, we bring to you the highlights of a panel discussion on the theme Competitiveness, Triumph of Regions, where distinguished personalities discuss how locations are playing an enabling role in driving industrial agglomeration.
What we are really trying to understand is that this whole idea of regions and location competitiveness. So I would like to start from a global perspective in terms of saying as to how do you think India is performing at this point in time? And how do you really see this grow as an economy? What is it that we need to do? But as we go along, I would really want to understand as to how do you really make location decisions yourself. So first and foremost, I would like to come to you, Kavinder. You have been within an industry which is at the forefront of making a location decision all the time. You have to make that choice each and every day of your life in terms of like where you want your resort to be, where you would like to see people coming in, and so on and so forth. And of course, from the global perspective as well. Where do you think this whole idea of regions and competitiveness is coming from?
I think in our business, the key thing is the location. When we set up resorts, we are trying to see whether we can even create destinations. In fact, Mahindra Holidays is known to create destinations. We were the ones who went first to Munnar. We were the ones who went first to places like Coorg. The key driver for us is rather simple, actually. The connectivity is critical, definitely, because if you expect people to land there, then connectivity and terrain and what kind of activities that you can organize for people to enjoy at the resort. We obviously were driven by our need to create destinations, and destinations happened to be in South. We had a lot of opportunity to do that, and therefore we even started by setting up our office in South of India. And I must say that one of the things that led us to move into Mumbai again was ability to attract talent. And there I bring in the next point, which is why do certain regions triumph over others? The availability of talent and all kinds of talent is definitely superior in places like Mumbai versus Chennai. So these are the determining factors in our journey at the beginning.
I have to really bring Prashant here. When you say talent, what is your idea of talent and how do you really see a location? Now, of course, there are those natural resources which become a very important factor.
For the manufacturing sector, location is a very key important thing. And whether it is, the infrastructure point of view, or whether it is the availability of the natural resources, or it is the availability of the skilled manpower. For last 40 years in India, the manufacturing sector is having a component of only 15 to 17% of GDP, and it has not been growing. And whatever the shrinkage you are seeing in agriculture sector is being taken away in the services sector. And that primarily has happened because of the lot of challenges with respect to location only and also ease of doing business. And look at China, look at Japan, Korea, whatever they created a special economic zones where the land, infrastructure, skilled manpower, everything was made available, and then the manufacturing sector could strive upon. So location is a very important thing with respect to not only availability of these three things, but also in terms of the logistics cost as well as skilled manpower.
Yatendra ji, I have to come to you here at this moment, you know. As a first generation entrepreneur, how did you really look at the location factor?
I think it would be very interesting to analyze the Silicon Valley concept. How the ecology to create cutting edge technology projects in that area, how it evolved. I mean, if you look at the entire composition of Silicon Valley, there are top of the line educational institutes which are on the cutting edge of research and development and upward technology innovations. If you talk about another component which builds up this scale faster, that is presence of defense sector. Because defense sector is always on an upward curve of technology, and that is where they use technology much before industry gets into it. What we are looking at IoT, what we are looking at everything, that was practiced by defense forces of US in 1989, where we could see war live. Third point, that there has to be an industry participation into this ecology in a futuristic manner. Now, point is that if you look at India scale, look at Bangalore. It had presence of heavy earth moving industry, it had presence of electronic hardware industry, it had presence of very good educational institutions right from Indian Institute of Science and all. What missing element which was required, that was participation of industry. We started building up by Y2K, and look at the kind of composition which has come up in Bangalore now. It is just not talking about IT, it is talking about all kind of biotech, talking about defense manufacturing.
Siddharth, I have to talk to you now. Somewhere, Yatendra, you were saying that educational institutions end up taking a back seat somewhere, like because of the long gestation period, and you were nodding as well. Would you agree to that assertion?
The thing is, although we are in the middle of what we generally call as a knowledge economy, I think all said and done, we are more of a knowledge imitation economy rather than a knowledge creation economy. So obviously, our educational institutes are also reflecting that, the imitation of knowledge rather than the creation of knowledge part. I'm not saying it's not happening, but the percentage balance is more in favor of imitation rather than creation side. So obviously, our educational institutes have a lot more to move forward.
Meera, I have to come to you. Everybody, each one of them is talking about talent. And you are in a field which talks about talent in a very unique and different way. How do you think the kind of people that you work with special people, they can actually create a transformation for enterprises? And at least four of them are sitting there. How do you think you can say something to them?
I help companies build an inclusive workforce, and the specific focus is on youth with disabilities. So I'll give you a recent example of what we did. There was this company which wanted to set base in the south because they got all the incentives for land, etc. But they didn't have skills. It was for diamond polishing. And as you know, the diamond polishing skills are all in Surat, pockets of Bombay, but you don't have that skill in the south. So we thought, why can't he hire youth with disabilities? Maybe let's look at a pocket which is really poor, which don't have legs, but which have eye-hand coordination. So all we did was a very simple, low-cost workplace adaptation of giving stools which can be raised upward and down because they don't have any legs at all, but they had perfect eye-hand coordination. And 80% of the workforce today is youth with disabilities, extremely focused on their task because they need their jobs, there's no attrition at all. And when any customers come, especially European customers and others come, these workforce are shown because it helps to build their brand. So I think we're constantly showing new solutions to industry on how this actually helps your business.
So Kavinder, your industry is one which has taken a step, and a very positive step, towards hiring and recruiting disabled or specially abled people. So how do you really look at this idea?
The initiative that we started almost a year and a half ago, we have now 64 specially abled people working in our various resorts. And, you know, we have resorts in literally back of the beyond places. So sometimes we find that even if we are able to recruit, retention is a problem. But when we taken the specially abled people, we realize that they stick longer, they have far more sense of loyalty. And in terms of their ability to do the job, definitely there are jobs which are in the back of the house, in the kitchen and various places where they are in a position to do the jobs. And even in the front office, when we have tried these people, actually our members have been very appreciative of these initiatives that we are taking. And I must say that this is also good business, because they stay, they are loyal, and they do a very, very good job.
Prashanti, I have to come to you. With enterprises like yours, like which work in fairly difficult terrains, so how do you really look at this problem? Like, have you ever, how do you solve this as you go along? Because very, very thinly populated areas, very huge lack of talent or availability of talent. And then, of course, you as well, as you said, the whole idea of distribution or supply chain and logistics. How do you solve this?
Yeah. So, actually, we are in a power industry, and, you know, when we are setting up a hydropower station, it's at up in the hills, or it's near the coal mines area. And these are all backward regions, and their talent pool is not available. But, you know, these are the large industries, and we have to create an inclusiveness around the society. So you have to set up the training centers so that those people develop the skills over a period of time, and then you improve their employability. Because in large industry, when you are creating near the backward regions, it's the only inclusive growth which can take you for a peaceful establishment of the for manufacturing sector. And going forward, these people get the employment near back their home.
Yatindra ji, attrition is a great thing to happen. And then when Prashant ji says, you know, like there are going to be people, we should train them, we should wait. As an enterprise, as a first generation enterprise, how would you really react to this point of view? Because I think you're two different realities. Like, there is one multi-billion dollar enterprise, and then you are first generation entrepreneur who does some amazing work, but has to look at talent differently.
See, if you spread the wings of young ones who come to work with you, you are not going to lose out in bargain. We always configure the retention period of our young talent who join us, maybe around 3 to 4 years. You have to be on go to get more out of young talent, and the more challenge you give it to them, more they will stay with you. Normally, with the younger lot, there are three things which are very, very important. One is element of challenge. Second is element of different things, variety. I mean, it cannot be a mundane thing what young guy will keep on doing year after year. And the third thing, that is money part, that they want quick money. Now, these three elements, how do you address them? See, there is always a level of opacity in the conduct of industry leaders while dealing with young people. What you should focus, that the way in which you train them, they should go out of your organization as ambassador of your company, which should add to your brand value. In return, you will get more talent, And those people, when they grow up in their life, and again, if they want to come back, they are welcome.
Sure. Each one of you, if I can actually, I'll start with you, Kavinder, and then I'll go to the professor the last, because I'll give him the final word. But Kavinder, in this very challenging environment that we are actually operating in, with global headwinds, which are becoming stronger in terms of like whatever we are seeing today, with how Indian economy is shaping up, location is a driver. We'll have to set a lot of things right. What do you think we should do as a country? Two or three things which is going to help us become more competitive, help us attract more investments, and make this country more prosperous.
Number one, we need to definitely make ease of doing business as very, very critical. We need to drive that. And second, we need to skill India in a big way to be able to attract investments and be competitive.
Very powerful.
India needs to make huge investments in infrastructure. Today, cost of logistics is 13 to 14% of GDP in India as compared to 7 to 8% in US and China. So we have very high cost of logistics. That's one thing which government needs to do. Second thing which is also important is the cost of capital. If the project financing is not going to happen in time to come, it is going to be a very, very big challenge. So we need to look at different credit models so that patient capital with a high gestation period is available at a low cost to the industry. Otherwise, it will be very, very challenging for manufacturing sector to come.
Yatendraji.
Whatever sector we talk about in India, the first important challenge is that we have a huge execution deficit. And there is a level of insincerity while accomplishing and executing what we decide. Whether it is government policy, whether it is an industrial project, whether it is social project, and that is a major issue, what we have to change our mindset, and we have to get on to the job, number one. So, few ideas, great execution. That is the first thing to take manufacturing sector forward. Number two, the most important thing, that what we really need to focus is something where, in a given scenario, how innovatively, how forcefully, and how speedily we can work out the things what we want to. If we have the will, there is a way.
Very, very interesting. Meera, over to you.
I think at large programs like Skilling India, we have to reap our demographic dividend. What is important is that the vulnerable segments are not like left out. Quite often we look at low-hanging fruits, but that's not enough. You need to look at pockets like persons with disability, girls, scheduled castes, those in unreached villages. And unless we skill them and give them equal opportunity to access to sustainable livelihoods, I think these programs won't be successful.
Siddharth.
Beyond the very good points already noted by other panelists, since we were talking about the location as the prime variable of consideration, see, I would say that nobody is going to move to a very remote corner or a very underdeveloped city just because there is a government push or a tax incentive or a special economic zone created. So what I understand is that the way to move forward and to push, develop more locations, business-friendly locations, is to pick up perhaps top 55 cities. 55 precisely, because those are the 55 cities with 10 million or more, million or more population in India. And so they provide the scale also. Develop them for a specific hub of an activity. Even if you have to talk to your competitor, take them along, set up the facilities there, because then you will be creating an ecosystem of your own kind. And then use that hub and perhaps the neighboring city or suburban areas, rural areas within that district as the spoke model. So this is known as hub and spoke model in economics of geography. And that will create the points, the centers of creative competitiveness and co-optation with your competitors also. So that will solve the problem of skill, capital, the ecosystem of the businesses. So specific to location, this, obviously other points as well. Thank you.
Thank you. I think this... on this high note, we'll just bring it to a close. Thanks a lot for all the panelists. Thanks a lot for joining us today.
insurance is seen as a sunrise industry. It is seen as an industry which can bring in talent, which needs to bring in a lot of innovation.
So one of the big challenges we face in management education is how do we combine theory and practice?
Disruption is nothing but change, but the only difference is it's a very rapid change.
Partnered by Times Influence.